Okay, let's talk about propellers on wild honey. I'm servicing the propellers, and as they're quite interesting, I thought I'd do a little video. On a cat of this size, you can either have inboard diesels or you can have outboards. We chose outboards because we couldn't really afford diesels at the time. And secondly, in our boat, it's pretty complicated to put diesels in. And the reason for that is simply because our boat sits on the beach. And if you want to put diesels in it, if it was a sail drive, it would stop you sitting on the beach. And we really haven't got the facility to run it sideways through the hull. And the other thing is that if we just cut a notch like a traditional boat and had a propeller in the back here, the hull is so wide here that the propeller would be hidden by the hull and wouldn't give you any thrust anyway. You've seen our basic track on the back rear beam where our engines just go up and down. We haven't got two tracks, it's quite a simple system. And you can either have them mounted further forward where they're in like bomb doors and they drop down out of the bottom of the bridge deck. If you imagine your engine's here, obviously your turning moment is less. Whereas if you have your engine nearer the corner of the back of the boat, then you've got better maneuverability. Especially if you've got a big wing mast or something, you've got all this windage and you've got this very little blue area in the water. So you can see you can get blown around quite easily. So having the engines at each corner gives you that extra maneuverability you need. The other disadvantage you've got is you have a bow wave and then the wave drops down in the middle and then comes up at the stern. And so that if you had your outboard mounted further forward, that would be in that trough between the bow and the stern wave. It means the engines have to be a bit deeper. And if you've got waves breaking in there, they're obviously compressed and there's nowhere for the water to go. So the engines are more vulnerable. Whereas if they're at the back, there's less compression from the bridge deck and the water's getting dissipated. So there's less chance of water ingress into the engines. I always knew I was pushing the limit by having the engines where I was, and I also had them at the minimum depth. When we launched the boat, I found out that the boat was floating quite a lot higher because obviously it didn't have its mast, and so the engines were actually a bit too high for the water intakes on the engines, and so I had to alter the brackets to lower them down a bit. I was pushing the boundary really at the depth at which I was going to try and run the engines. So to start with, we decided to do nothing. We were just going to see how it worked out. And actually we did quite a few trips, and the one thing we did notice is that as we were going through waves, and particularly as we have to go out through a river mouth, we often into the surf, we noticed that the engines weren't as sweet as they are when they're in flat water. My initial thoughts of a solution was to fit an end plate above the propeller. Rather than build my own, I decided to go for one of these, which you all know what they are. You see them on their little outboards, on little tenders everywhere. They're the little hydrofoil that clips onto the fence on the engine. I had this brainwave. I was going to turn it the other way up. And so instead of giving the lift that this hydrofoil is meant to give you, lift from your engine to help you get onto the plane, I was going to use it the other way and pull the stern of the boat down, and I thought this was a great idea. And so I luckily only bolted them onto one engine, and then we trundled out the river. Of course, it's fine in flat water. And then we got into the waves, and what happened is it trapped a huge air bubble underneath it. The propeller's just sucking air onto the blade. The RPM's going, there's absolutely no thrust coming from the engine. We have to just carry on out through the river with one engine, haul this engine up, and I'm hanging over the back of the boat, undoing the bolts and taking this thing off. When we came back into the harbour, the solution was actually to put them the way they were meant to go. It certainly reduced a bit of the pitch, because obviously bolted onto the engines, they provide resistance to the pitching motion of the boat. But whether they were making the propellers any more efficient was a bit debatable. So we used the system for a couple of years, and what we found was that if we were on a passage and the wind dropped out and it got a bit light and we couldn't sail and we needed to get to our destination, and often the sea state was still pretty rough, we found that just motoring in rough water wasn't that efficient. We suffered from the RPM going up and down. The engines were constantly going, wow, wow, and you know, we are losing thrust forwards. It made me think about cupping the propellers. And then when I was in Cornwall, I met this guy and we were having a beer looking over the stern of the boat, and he was a propulsion expert, a guy into propellers, Zapcats, because Zapcats, they're operating in a lot of aerated water. And the discussion was that, yeah, I should take these off because they were still probably trapping little bits of air and creating ventilation on the propeller, and that I should go for a cup propeller. So what does cupping mean? One of the problems with multi-hulls, as we said, is pitching. So going up and down, and obviously the engines are on the back, and you can see that the propellers tend to go up and down. And if I hold that standard propeller and show it straight to you, you can see it's fairly smooth sized. So what you can imagine is as that gets pulled up and down in the water just shears off that when the boat's pitching, and you lose a lot of drive from the propeller. The propeller accelerates, you can hear the RPM of the engine go up, and you lose that propulsion forwards. And cupping means, if you look at this blade, it's got a little scoop on the trailing edge of the blade. When this blade goes up and down, you can see the cup is resisting. It's gripping the water better than the smooth bladed propeller. If I hold that blade close to you, you can see that this area here is now scooped. So as the water tries to release, it hits this edge. Propellers that are designed to drive in an aerated water, they will be heavily cupped because they need the grip to send the boat forward. And that's effectively what cupping is. I mean, that's a sort of simple explanation because propellers are pretty damn complicated, as I found out. I was looking for a way to see if I could demonstrate the difference between the straight blade and the cup blade.
I'm going to take the original propeller, I'm going to put him in the water, and so I'm just going to pull him, and then you can see that there's a very little disturbance off the trailing edge of the blade. Now, if I then get the cup blade and I put that in and then I drag it through the water again, you'll see that that lovely little vortice gets produced off the trailing edge of the propeller. And that's just showing the propeller with the cup has got more grip in the water when it's moved in the vertical plane.
I had a spare propeller. We were on passage and the hub stripped out. We put the engine into gear and nothing really happened. We had to go and anchor somewhere, and I had to dig up the rubber hub and fill it with epoxy so that we could use the engine. So I've had these spare propellers, so I thought, ideal, I'll practice. And so what I did was I got a metal ball of the diameter that I thought was about the right size, and I put it on and I started tapping the blade around. And actually this propeller bent reasonably well and reasonably accurately, and it did provide a better performance in rough water, undoubtedly. And so then I decided that I was going to modify the real propellers that were on the boat. But when I modified them, I decided to go slightly more extreme than this propeller, because you know, you're always trying to push the limits. As always, your sort of prototype works really well, but when I came to do it on the main propellers, the castings weren't as good as this casting, and so they were pretty bad and they sort of started to crack and get damaged. And so on future versions I did a little bit of bending, but then I had to fill it with epoxy. You have to sort of use this Yamaha propeller because they're very specific to the 9.9 engine. The latest Voyage, they work pretty well. They work really well in rough water. They give much more drive. They are prone to a little bit of damage because it's filler, but there was a disadvantage to it. And we found that out in France when we had to go into marina. We don't often go into marinas, but with Brexit and everything, you have to go into marinas now to check in. We ended up getting put into a very tight spot with the wind blowing us onto the quay. And obviously we had to spring ourselves off with a spring line, and we just couldn't get off the quay because our little engine going astern wasn't giving us enough thrust. And so when I got back, I decided, yeah, a bit too extreme. What I've decided to do is to go to stage 3, which is to make the cup less extreme, but enough that we get the drive. And hopefully when we go astern, it still gives us relatively good performance. who likes a great little experiment? I'm going to get each propeller, and we'll start off with the original propellers, and we'll just see how they thrust backwards and forwards in the tank so that I can get it clear in my head as to whether I'm going in the right direction. Hey presto, here it is, the experimental tank. Well, it's a pretty rough experiment, to be honest, and we're really only interested in the propeller going astern. This is the propeller. It's attached to a shaft that goes to the cordless drill. Yeah, that's nice. You can feel it just wanting to pull away. I'll switch to the one that we're using currently. Oops, I just disconnected myself. Actually, it feels... I would have said that's nearly as good as the one that we've got at the moment. A bit of a dodgy trigger there. The final propeller. And again, let's hope I don't splash everything too much. To be honest, it's pretty close. Obviously, it's not the world's most scientific experiment. We're not trying to redesign or reinvent the wheel. We just want to make the propellers that we're using on our boat work as best they can. So what did I learn from the shenanigans there? Well, we had the baseline propeller, which was the Yamaha standard propeller. And that was gave a reasonable thrust backwards. Found that our current propeller I could hold quite easily going astern, so it's not giving me very much drive. And mysteriously, the one that I thought would give improved seemed to be almost better than this one. It seems as though by refining this edge here, you can gain a bit more efficiency going astern. So I'm going to grind it off a bit, and I'm going to put a very fine layer of glass cloth to hopefully increase the durability of the edge of the blade. Okay, we've fared it up a bit, and on a couple of these corners here we've knocked off all the filler, and I'm going to have to build up just the tips so that they're all exactly the same, because obviously if they're slightly out when we come to spin it, you'll find one propeller blade is too heavy. There'll be some inaccuracy anyway, but provided it doesn't create a vibration, it's not really a problem. It started to rain heavily on my shed, so it's pretty noisy. So I've masked those out. I'm going to use a sort of mix of aluminium dust and microfibers to just build that area up. We just really want these to be a bit more durable. As you can see, I've just put some white glass over this area. And what you have to do is sand it and then immediately get resin on so that it bonds well, because the aluminium to epoxy isn't that brilliant a joint. I'm just beefing up this area. So this is the process, and we're just trying to stop a little bit of fill getting knocked out. Okay, so you've modified your propeller, and now you're trying to find out whether you've got each blade roughly the same and that the propeller's in balance. This workmate's set up so level in all planes. And we've just clamped this piece of tube on, and then we're going to spin the blade, and we've numbered all the blades on the propeller, and you can see this propeller is quite happy to sit at pretty much any blade. If one blade was heavier than the others, then that would always go down. So this is showing that it's more or less okay, good enough for me anyway. It's a very simple way of doing it, and it means that if you're just doing some little mods in your garage, that's a simple way of just checking your propellers balanced. So this is our final propeller that we're going to put on the boat, and we're going to use this season, and hopefully it's the best compromise between the extreme cup and the straight prop, and hopefully it'll give us better propulsion astern and also still give us the benefits of the cup propeller in the rougher water.